So, introducing BDD with a happy end. That's what I thought I would present. Introducing BDD, what it means, well, it's up to you to decide. Happy end of sub-optimizing, as I see it currently, but more on that later, probably. So, who I am? I'm a hiking guide of Suomen Latu. That means that I'm a leader in situations where earning trust really matters. Being there in Lapland a whole week somewhere where we don't even have cell phones working, there isn't opportunity or there must not be problems with trust, people trusting me. So yes, I am one of the organizers of Turku Agile Day. It's a great conference. This year also what happens is that there's a bunch of different organizations doing great deal of collaboration together. We are having Turku ICT Week, so there are some flyers here. I will give those to Dimitri. And there is interesting thing, on Monday there's business-to-business meetings with Finnish and companies from Baltics. So if you're interested, I'll have one of these, some of these, and I'll give Dimitri also. So I'm a blipper, meaning I have a camera with me always, every day. There's my little princess and me. I'm going to tell a story of my workplace at Lindorf. Yes, we are a debt collector, market leader, European level. And the story is about we trying to go to new markets, going to invoicing business, and we're creating invoicing services. So even though we are debt related, debt related administrative services, I'm not currently working on that part of business. So introducing BDD, does it mean A, BDD basics, or B, how I introduce BDD into the current company, into Lindorf? So do you want to hear about BDD basics, how we do it from that perspective, or what I did to make us to start doing BDD? It's your choice. Not yet, soon. I'll start by telling a story. And then when the story ends, you'll have a choice. And this is the reason is that having a talk, making a talk beforehand, I don't know where you guys want to listen. So I want to give you an option to select from. So some history. From 2008, doing some acceptance testing with Robot Framework, then we changed to Cucumber. And in 2010, we started to have first trials on getting customer on board with our Cucumber. Excellent book by Matt Wynn. By the way, Matt is coming to Turku Agile Day. He's a great guy. And Matt actually said that please do buy it from pragmatic programmers instead of Amazon.com since they get more money out of it. So I promise to say that. So I started Scrum Master in Lindorf as a team of nine just around a year ago. They're really, really junior people, really young people, anxious people, wanting to learn a bunch of new stuff. We had weekly sprints. We mostly failed to deliver. More or less every second sprint we failed, and then we succeeded, failed, succeeded, failed, succeeded. It was a rather frustrating times. Sometimes it happened so that we worked on one story for 2 weeks, then we presented that to the business and they said, this wasn't what we wanted for. Ever seen that? We have a few agile coaches there visiting for us. There's one especially I remember, Petri Heirama, coming there for 2 days to discuss with us regarding agile as such. It was a stormy time, stormy weather. I had every single morning discussions with some of my managers. And every single morning they said, what's wrong with all this? Why doesn't it work? You must do this, you must do that. We require you to do this and that. And every single morning, I just said, we'll work it out. We'll work it out. Just relax. I listened to them and I said, we'll work it out. And what I did what I was best at. I did nothing. I'm a scrum master. I did nothing to hinder the development effort. What I did, that's a different story. I actually did something. They wanted me to be here, where to be, in the front, telling where to go, what to do. I would say that would be my thoughts around that time was they wanted some kind of micromanagement of some sort. And I wanted this. I'm there, I'm the hiking guard here, I'm just somewhere in here, in the middle. I'm not the first one in there. There's people coming next to me. Some might be even walking away, walking a few meters, tens of meters ahead of me. I don't mind. So at the time also, I did what I believed. I wasn't part of the micromanagement thingy. I lived my dream. I believed in myself. But for a brief moment, I had the thought, what if they are right? Luckily, that was only a brief moment of time. Around that time, we made a few changes there. We changed from internet-based Kanban board, Scrum board, whatever, to an informative workspace. We had Kanban board or Scrum board, I don't care, in a big wall in the area. We changed to new acceptance testing tool. I don't say even behavior-driven development tool, it was an acceptance testing tool, which was an easy way to introduce the process. And one thing what I managed to help them is to get closer cooperation with the business, which is actually key point in it. Then a magic happened last summer. 1st of July, there came people from the top management, like really top management. There was, I think, it's kind of the CEO of Lindor Field who came to us. And he said, well, this is what you have to do. 550 story points by the end of this year. Just remember what Vasco said on the first. What is the value of thing? Is it the story points or is it something else? We were given the task of completing 550 story points by the end of the year. Someone had made some calculations. The interesting of that is that there were 6 months, of which one is summer holiday, and we calculated, well, we were engineers and we could calculate ourselves, that with the current velocity we would still be doing work. And we were given a set of features, we were given time. This is what you have to deliver. Does it sound agile or not? It did seem and still does seem quite a climb to a mountain. Once we heard this, we took the teams, the Scrum Masters took the teams, there were two teams working on that. We started to discuss what it means. And that was actually one of the best group discussions I've ever been with. Since from that discussion, the attitude changed from this can't be done to what is the first step for us? What is the first step we can do? And what is the things we require from the business? Since if they want something, we want them to help us. So we came up with three things, first steps. I will discuss that later as part of the process or things we're but we actually did. And after that, that was 30 minutes, 1 hour discussion with the team. We actually changed, the attitude changed from this can't be done, this is impossible, how stupid they can be, to let's try, what's the first step we can do? Well, anyway, it resulted in, you just need to make it happen. You just need to make it happen. And if you don't, they didn't say this, it's by my agile. But the end result is, this is a goal, 550 story points, and you know that 550 story points is not a goal. It doesn't bring any customer value, but it's a number which they love. Just about this picture. So the yellow one here is inner extrapolation of the velocity we were having. We had quite steady velocity at the time when we started, somewhere around here. So we had quite numbers to back up that at the end of the year we would be somewhere around here. And then we did some Excel calculus and we decided that, okay, if we were really much, what would happen if we at the end of the year would produce double the amount of stories and would have gradually grow the amount of stories we get completed every sprint, and we would still be far away from 550. And then we did some more Excel calculus, so we decided which were curve that we need to follow. And the most amazing thing is that we followed the line up to here when they decided, well, there's the last things here are so vague that we don't actually know yet what they mean, what are the last stories. We actually took one third of the people away. We took those to a separate team. I went with them to the separate team, and there was two thirds of the people continuing. And this whole, the last times was, well, the last last 2 months were kind of vague. We had vague business needs, really customer specific things, and we needed to have the answers from the customers. At this point, we all knew that we actually did it. We did achieve the miraculous 550, which doesn't, well, we achieved it, and we were celebrating. So how does this reflect to BDD? I think there is a great lot of value in BDD, and the one thing that made this possible is something we did on that. And now it's your call, and I need one volunteer. Yes, please, could you stand up and just... let's do it this way. We'll have a vote. So first, those who want to hear about BDD basics, and what you need to do is you have to make a guess which one people want. So, those who are in favor of BDD basics, raise your hand, please. And those in favor of introducing change, please raise your hand.
Change it is.
Introducing change. Cool. I rehearsed this once, and at that time I did the BDD basics. So the first thing was when I joined Indorf, I actually didn't know where what I was going to do there. I just went there. They just wanted me there to work. At one point, the team wanted me to be their Scrum Master. So I started to be their Scrum Master. Until that, I was a programmer with them. Developers, we do also testing. Programmers. The motto here is a motto from Suomenlahti to Hiking Mice, which actually depicts quite well what I did. whatever I did, the first also the two slides showed it, I wasn't there in the front saying what to do, where to go, what's the next step. Instead, I was there with the crew, within the group, with them, helping them to make decisions, helping them to experiment. I was present, and I was not always visible. For example, one thing, I never ever, in one Scrum demo, I had anything to say. Not once did I present the results. Not once did I say anything in there. It was always the team actually who did. Since it was their joy, they had accomplished. It wasn't me. One core thing that when I joined Lindorf and wanted there to be improved was the use of feedback loops. BDD is a great tool for that, since we had the story of one case that we implemented the story for 2 weeks, that is two sprints. And at the end of the second week, we demonstrated it to the customer, business, and the business said, this wasn't what we wanted for. So we wanted faster feedbacks. And part of BDD is also feedback loops in a certain level. So what I actually did was that Matt Wynn, who was a great guy who comes to Drupal Agile, has a great podcast on refactoring your queues. It's a video which he presented somewhere, I actually don't know where, last spring. It's a fun video. It's 30 minutes, of which 15 first minutes is you just get to laugh all the time. So we actually watched that video with all the teams. And this picture is from that video. It's about the feedback loops. Feedback loops which we were missing the feedback, this feedback loop. We were having the ideas, requirements from the business, and we went all the way to code it. Then we did some unit testing, we did some acceptance testing to see that, okay, it works. And then after each sprint, or two sprints, or three sprints, depending on when we were ready, we showed it to the business. And they said, well, it might be okay. And this is what we wanted to do. So we discussed about how to improve, how to get one feedback loop earlier. So the people, the developers, actually wanted one business people there with whom we could talk the features we are implementing in BDD, features which we, I'll discuss that later. So what we did was we spent 30 minutes of work watching the video, then we discussed it, and people wanted, developers wanted, yes, we need something like this. We've had the problems of getting the feedback quite late, getting it right ready, and then getting a feature ready, and then get a feedback from the customer or from the business that this wasn't actually what we wanted. So what I did with the process or how we experimented it, this is more or less one of the few things where I actually said something, well, what if we would do something like this? Initially, we had something and then we improved. But I had the initial thought of how it should be. How we could experiment, start experimenting. This is a picture of more or less how we are doing it now. It wasn't how we started. And no, by the way, this did or did not work in our context. You might even see that, folks, user acceptance testing demo review, so there might be some problems with that order and all that. So what I presented them was to have a release backlog pruning kind of chance for us to discuss with the business. So these are the requirements that these are the features we want. At that point, we actually didn't have any visibility into the future when I introduced this. So I wanted us to have visibility into the future, so more visibility than 1 or 2 weeks, which we had. I thought that what if we would start when doing the release backlog grooming and when getting into stories, what if we write acceptance criteria on a card, on the other side of the card? And then I thought, what if we start experimenting with executable specifications? Let's try it once. It's one sprint, two sprints. Do some implementation. I didn't have anything to say here, but these are things that evolves all the time. So the things I started, things I actually proposed were only those three outputs: release backlog grooming to get visibility, what the business wants, what are the features we are going to implement in the near future. To get the acceptance criteria by story beforehand, so that we know what we are doing, and to start trying this new tool, test automation tool. What the developers wanted, they wanted business here. I didn't mention about who should be where, who should be doing what, and that's what. The developers, with our discussions, decided. So it actually meant also that I had to influence the business quite much, since they haven't done anything like this before. They haven't done any backlog crewing. For that, the backlog came from business to our product owner, maybe. I don't know how our product owner got the features we needed to do. And from there to us. And now, when I came there and we started to do these things, we said, we want to have some visibility into the future. We want to know what's coming up. So we did the release backlog pruning, and we have these sessions nearly always off-site. Whenever we are doing a massive amount of when we want to have visibility for 1 or 2 months ahead of us, of the time now, or even more, we're going offsite so that we're not at the office. So that was one thing. And there's always good coffee wherever we go. How we get there, how we got the business in there, I don't know. We didn't give them a chance to say no. We just said them that, well, you actually need to be there. The business promised to help. And on the day when we had the 550 story points task, business promised to help us. At that day, we actually required two things. We required business people to sit next to us. So two business people came to sit next to us in the development area. So that was done like the same day, 1st of July, Friday. The business people, we took space there for them to sit, and they actually came to sit just next to us. That was also for what we required was that the business people are with us when we're going to do the release backlog crewing. Just before that, it was only our product owner. And our product owner, by the way, was really technical. He was an ex-developer, not really product owner, not really knowing the domain as such, and the customers. So we got business with us. So So we got business to work with us. This is the way we experimented with tracking where we are. And tracking where we are was actually one thing that we promised ourselves, that we need to know day by day how we're progressing with where we are going. We need to see in the work group, this wasn't my idea, this was the team's thoughts. They wanted to see every day where we are with regards to the goal we were having. We started something like we had only dates there. This is kind of the story, or the backlog item, sorry. And there were some dates when we had enough information so we could count that as being part of backlog, or actually when the product owner knew that. When did we hear about the access criteria, so go through that with the teams. When we made the executable specifications, when we started working on coding or implementing it. Change the number, user access testing, and done. And by the way, you might hear that there are some handovers from when we have done acceptance criteria to then the next handover to executable specifications, and from there to implementation. Yes, there are a lot of handovers, small handovers there. That's why I said it did or did not work in our context. There's a huge handover here from development to testing. How many of you have or know Cucumber, the tool? How many of you know this kind of given when then style of doing tests, doing access criteria? This is a thing that often is said about, well, this is BDD. Start by making tests that look like this. That was the way, as I mentioned, we started with a new access testing tool. We started with a new access testing tool, which just happened to be one that supports Gherkin. Gherkin is the language here used by these tools. This is we are using SpecFlow, and this is actually one of my own learning projects. So we start, or that was actually quite a thing. When we used just an unit style acceptance testing before, every acceptance test we had to do all the initializations in every acceptance test again, and then there was a lot of duplicated code and all that stuff. And I introduced this one tool. Actually, I introduced only the concept of Cucumber, and they came up with a tool, SpecFlow, which is a .NET tool or a .NET import of Cucumber. So then I asked, well, what if you would try it out? Few people tried it out. They said it is so slow. It is so slow. There's a lot of overhead with the tool. Okay? If you say so. But then what happened was that one of my really good friends started to work at us, Lindorf, and he's a real test-minded person. So what he did was, he took a task, he took a story, and he actually wrote the whole scenarios for that story. He wrote what the story was about, he wrote all the scenarios to fulfill the acceptance criteria. And when he was done, all the other developers went to see him. What are you doing? Hey, that looks nice. Doesn't mean that we just need to do once this code that initializes these things. We used to do that for all the tests we have. That looks nice. Had that person not been there, it might be that we wouldn't still be using you go for it. What we wanted, or what the team wanted, was part of also the feedback cycle, thinking that we want to know where we are going, where we are, how we are progressing with regards where we are now. For that we had burn-up charts used, so on. We had big informal Kanban boards. We had whatever they wanted me to use for them. They said what they wanted, and I just did. If I wanted something, I actually could either I just did it and had the burden on myself, or just what I actually did was I discussed with them, would this be of any benefit? But communicating plans, that's a challenge. Yes, we do have some communicating plans. Currently, I'm working on a second project now in Europe. And now we're having even more business people sitting next to us, even closer to us than before. We went to see a customer the other night. Now, guess what we saw at the customer? The business people actually presented a schedule that we committed to, and we never saw it before. So we are having some problems with communicating plans, where we are, what is expected from us. Part of this is actually what I said, what we have done is to sub-optimize the goal. We have failed in the Scrum Masters and in the Scrum Masters and our manager failed in building. Working together with the business, that was the best time we had. But that was kind of just part of the business. Those people that were working on the invoicing system. So we were collaborating mostly with them. So there was still some gap with the business as the top management. One thing which I didn't mention about BDD, exploratory testing, which I think when doing BDD or any agile, well, in agile to do BDD to do exploratory testing is really important thing. We've had some problems with it, and a lot to learn. Since for us, it's mostly about ad hoc testing, aiming to find all the bugs flying around, which isn't actually the thing ETE is meant for. So what I do for that, I try to ask questions, I try to help them to find solutions. And luckily I have this one guy in the team that we're working or in a team that is tester oriented. And currently we are in the second project, we are having really, really good ETA. We're having ETA where we are trying to gain understanding of the project, of the tool. We're trying to check boundaries. What happens when we are creating loads and loads of data? What happens when we are creating data that's that doesn't fulfill all the requirements data? What happens if we give data that's empty, that doesn't have any value, that doesn't have values there somewhere? So these are the things that has happened. The team actually learns, they try new things. They've said they themselves want to try things out. I haven't been telling them do this or do that. I haven't been the one in the front leading the way in a way that this is how we have to go. Please follow me. I've been the whole time somewhere in the middle, just working with them. One problem we're actually having also now, or no problem, but about the feedback loops, how we are thinking about them now. What we are trying to accomplish now, or this is also from, well, this is actually more or less my thoughts now. But what we are trying to do with the team is that these are the things we are doing pretty much within the development team. What we are trying to do is to have business up until the scenario level tests, which is behavior tests, executable specifications we are working on. So it was just a few weeks ago, team members, we had a discussion what to have a retro topic, and they actually said, what can we as a team to help? What can we as a team to do to help business to work with us more on this level? What we can do to help them to come closer to us? What we can do to help them to collaborate with us better? The same, that actually pretty much things what I've been trying to do always is trying to help what I can do to help the team and the team with the business to help them to work together more. So to close to the end, what made this possible? Was it BDD? Partially, yes. We started to work together with the business, and I'm pretty sure that the collaboration, we know what to do. They gave us access criteria. We didn't have any more situations that a story was demonstrated to the customer, sorry, to the business, was rejected. Was it only BDD? No way. Is it the silver bullet? No. One thing actually what happened around this area was that our manager decided that, well, it's not his job to have his hands on us. So he just let it go. All the responsibility left to us, to the developers. Since spring, when we had the discussions, what's wrong with all this? And we were this close actually to break down the teams and start something totally new. To a situation where our manager just said that, well, you work it out in a good way, in a way that he was there for us if we needed him. Whenever we needed him with regarding to talk with the business or help us with. When I showed this last time, there was a question, how much did it matter that the end here, or was it so that the end was this low because of we took all the easy stories first? Interesting thing about the story of 550. This is the original number of stories, by the way, in this picture. Number of stories, original stories. We did actually estimate all these. Actually, we didn't even estimate all those. This is the amount of stories that we, from the original backlog, we never finished. This part here is stories that are added to the backlog later. One third of the stories that were implemented. The this curve here, actually, the yellow one, which is the done curve, done means that we handed those to the testers, follows quite literally the same curve as the number of story points done. So, to conclude, I have 6 words to finish it up. This is a great TED talk. All TED talks in 6 words. It's really worth to watch. That's fun. No, it wasn't that. I know. So, the idea, the 6 words of the topic, of how I introduced change, how I got the team and the business to work together, to collaborate together, how I got them to try out BDD, and how I got them to work as they are doing now, and how they're working is that they are constantly learning. So build trust and help them experiment. Thank you. So, any questions?
Okay, who got a question? Please raise your hand. We'll hand the microphone. So, no lunch without questions. Okay, we have a volunteer who will save us.
Mentioned that business people didn't know anything about the customer. They knew a lot that there were gaps there. And you pointed out them. How did you point it out and what did you do? Did you start doing user tests or something else?
So there was a gap with business people and the customer. I might have said that, but I don't quite know what I meant.
Okay, not a problem. Sometimes it happens. So, if there is no more questions, okay, another one volunteer. Getting interested. Okay, here we are.
So you were saying that you help the business people come together with the developers together and then work together as a team. So in, I think it's a perfect life. I mean, the developers see the business people agrees that they are doing well and then give some feedback. But in real life, business people are actually leading like 5 to 10 projects in simultaneous, and they cannot just come and sit together with one team. They have like 5 teams leading. How can you? How maybe you have some ideas how to get business people closer than?
Yes, that was good question and good thought. That yes, that does happen. That business people have multiple teams to lead, multiple projects to lead. That also happens in our case. So what I mean with what the business people actually means for us is the business people working with us are business. It's a tester that's done the thing that we are actually doing, done invoicing, so he has domain knowledge quite extensively. And there was one other representative who knows a lot about the domain. So the business people we had weren't those who are leading like the top management, but there was business representatives. One could say for example, in the current team where I'm working, there is, I would say that would be a business analyst coming from business side. To analyze what are the customer needs and to help those. So maybe there's someone to help. It doesn't have to be like in our case. We just had the top management there to come weekly to have discussions. We had a weekly meeting there. But other than that, there were the business representatives sitting with the developers, working with the developers.